Okay, so today for the last lecture, I want to address a slightly different question than the two previous ones, namely a kind of refinement of what we have seen so far. So imagine that you have a sequence of finite graphs which converge in Benjamin-Isham limit to some probability rho, which is the unimodular distribution on random weighted graphs. Then by the convergence theorem of we know that the empirical distribution of eigenvalues, they converge to the spectral measure, the average spectral measure of this object. A consequence of that is that if f is a support of the spectral measure of rho, the proportion of eigenvalues which are an epsilon neighborhood of this support will go to 1, right? So the basic question I want to speak about today is are there other eigenvalues? And if not, how can you... So this just say that the proportion, there is a vanishing proportion of eigenvalues, at most vanishing proportion of eigenvalues, which is outside any neighborhood of the limit support. Okay, so there is a first comment. We have seen that the map which to mu gn gives the map which to a spectral a measure rho gives mu rho is continuous for the Benjamin-Isham topology. Okay, so in fact, it implies that the typical eigenvalues, which are what this describes, the typical eigenvalues, they just depend on the typical neighborhood around points. Okay, so eigenvalues which will be outside of these intervals, they will depend. They can be of two types only. Well, roughly, they can be of two types. Either they will be responsible of a local neighborhood around an atypical point in your graph, or they will be present due to some global geometric structure in your graph. Let's give a very down-to-earth example. If G is a d-regular, if G is a d-regular graph, okay, and let's say on n vertices, okay, so you order the eigenvalues of the adjacency like that, so the adjacency matrix has positive entries, has non-negative entries, so the first eigenvalue is d, and this is a Peyron eigenvector. Okay, but if there is a second if the second eigenvalue is also equal to d, it means that there are two connected components. So you see, eigenvalues which are outside the limit support of they reflect, or the fact that lambda n is minus d, says that the graph is bipartite, and so on. So outliers, so eigenvalues which will be typically outside of this set, can be are made possible thanks to global geometric property of the graph. Okay, and there is a famous theorem which Eyal already mentioned, which is a theorem by Friedman. Which says that in 2008, which says that if G is sampled uniformly among all d-regular graphs with n vertices, so d is fixed, and okay, nd is even, then with high probability, say maybe I can write it properly, for any epsilon, the probability that the second largest eigenvalue, or the smallest one, as the absolute value of the last one, is larger than 2 square root of d minus 1 plus epsilon goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. Okay, so this is exactly in this case, gn, when you have a uniform d-regular graph, the limit distribution is the Dirac mass at the infinite d-regular tree. We have seen that mu rho is this Kestel-Mackey distribution whose eigenvalues, whose support is interval minus 2 square root d minus 1 dir minus 1, so this is mu of the infinity regular tree. So it says that there are, apart from the trivial eigenvalue, which is the Perron eigenvalue, which just all the others, they are in an epsilon neighborhood of the limit support. Okay, so we would like to try to explain you how this phenomena has some kind of some kind of generality, and I will study a particular example. So this behavior should be expected, even if there is no, should be expected for probably any reasonable local operator that you can define on a graph, and any natural random graph ensemble. Okay. Let's see. So we will take a specific model, which will be very simple. So. Let's see what. So I will not to try to convince you at least at the beginning that what I'm going to speak about has some generality. We will look at instead of looking at the adjacency matrix, we will look at weighted adjacency matrix. So let me tell you what is that. I take n will be even. Okay, and I have. So Si, there are permutations on the n elements which are matching. So Si, so there are the, sigma I are matchings, meaning that for any x, sigma I of x is different from x, and sigma I squared of x is equal to x. Okay, and Si is a permutation matrix. Of sigma I, of, yeah. Okay, so what does it describe? It describes, if you look at the graph, where you have around any each point, you have three neighbors, well, three, if d is equal to three, okay, so you can color the edge by the index here, and you put a weight, which is a1, a2, a3. Okay, and every other neighbor see exactly the same local environment. So I think it's called anisotropic. We take the sum of the AI as being one. So it's it's a kind of anisotropic random walk. So I borrowed the name from Nalini. There is a book on Talamanca. And? There is a book on, we'll see, on an operator which is of this type. Okay, so if the AI, so what we will do, we will be interested in a model where the SI, the sigma I, the matching, so it's a matching, in a model where the matching are uniformly sampled among all possible matchings. Okay, so the sigma I. Uniformly sampled. Okay. So if the AI is equal to 1, this statement is essentially the Friedman theorem. Okay, so that's the model. Yes?
Instead of what is the best known thing for G and D, instead of epsilon, I want to put. N to
minus a third
or minus
two thirds? You mean a conjecture about the epsilon? Or what is known or what is conjectured?
How far you need to increase the support in order to capture with probability reading all the eigenvalues except the bigger ones?
So what I proved is if you take log n over log n squared, with some constant, that's what I proved. But if you take anything which would be larger than n minus, maybe I will have it wrong, 2/3. Should be true, but this is a big conjecture. This is true for that's not been proven yet, but this would be consistent with Tracy-Widom scaling. Okay. So that's the model. So the first part, I will first. There is a refinement. The statement I said that most of the eigenvalues they will be close to the epsilon neighborhood of the limit support. In fact, when the AI are positive, there is a very nice bound that which is called the Allon-Boppana bound, which you can think as which is a quantitative way to and much more general way to give a lower bounds on lambda 2 or lambda n. So what is this bound about? So first we need to define an the same operator, but on an infinite dirregular tree. Okay? So you remember we had the infinite dirregular tree, so it would be convenient to see it as a D copy of a Cayley graph of D copy of Z2. And with the generator, okay, so you have three words in my picture. So here you have the root of the tree. You have it's a Cayley graph, and then you have when you multiply by G1, you consider the point AR, A1, A3, A4. Okay, so and you define an operator in L2 of the tree, which you can write exactly the same way. AI, and you replace the permutation, the matchings, by multiplication by the GI. So you can write like that, where the lambda is the left regular representation of the. Okay, so this we have already seen this notation. Okay, so this operator is the same model, but just on the infinite tree. Okay. And. So the book of Fickert, Alamanca, and Steiger is about this anisotropic random walk on a graph, on an infinite tree. So the norm, the operator, we will be only interested by the operator norm of this. So its spectrum, if you look at the spectral measure at the root, for this operator I star, it has some density that you can compute, which generalize Kesten-Mackey distribution. It has some. It is symmetric, contrary to my picture. And here, you have the operator norm of this object and minus. Okay, and there is a formula which is was proved by Ackmann and Ostrand in 70. Something, which says that the operator norm of A is the inf over all positive numbers of 2s plus the sum of the square root of the AI square plus S square minus S. So if all AIs are equal, you plug this formula, you take the inf, and you will get 2 square root of d minus 1. Okay? So what is this? The Allon-Boppana bound will say that, in fact, you can lower bound the second eigenvalue of this operator of this matrix A by A star up to a vanishing error term. Yes.
Essential to that you're assuming the weights are positive.
So, for this formula, no. I mean, you say it could be complex, and you will have a module square. If you, no, they cannot be complex in this setting. So AI square. So the, no. So no. For this formula, they need not be positive. But and since it's an operator on a tree, it does not depend on the sign of the variable. So. But for the Allon-Bopalin bound, there is some positivity of the entries which will play into a role, so play a role. So. So what is this Allon-Bopalin bound? So I will give you the Moir argument for Allon-Bopalin bound. So as we have seen, this is the start, the same argument that we have seen already a few times. So there are two points in the graph. So I come back to this model. There is a graph, of course. So we call G the graph which depends on the sigma 1 up to sigma d. OK, so I found it more convenient to define the adjacency matrix directly, but there is a graph underlying that. So we can find two points which match, whose distance are equal to the diameter of the graph. OK, so if you grow, it means that you will find two points whose ball of radius, if you take h, which is less than the diameter of the graph divided by 2, you will find two points such that the balls are around each of these points are non-intersecting. Then the second eigenvalue of A, so the lambda 1 are just like that, the eigenvalues of this matrix A. The second eigenvalue of A is at least by the courant Fischer-Weierstrass formula, at least the largest the second eigenvalue of the graph. So now maybe I should write the second value of A is at least the second eigenvalue of the graph where I remove everything else but those two balls. I put to zero all entries outside that. So let's call this P of X of H. Okay, but these two balls, they are disjoint, so the second eigenvalue is just the minimum of the largest eigenvalue of this operator restricted to this ball and this operator restricted to this ball. Okay, but my graph is completely homogeneous, so these two measures, so this is equal to the minimum okay, but these two numbers are equal, so this is lambda 1 of A restricted to B X over H. Okay. Now, this is where the fact that the... What is the... If we'd like, for example, to count the moments of A or A restricted to in my graph G. Okay, and you take K even. Oh, wait, you don't need that for this argument. Okay, so I claim that this is at least the number of the same thing but on the tree. Why is that? You remember this is the sum of, maybe there will be this is the sum of, let's put here EX and here let's put E naught. This is the sum of closed paths from X to X of length K times the product of the weights that I have gathered on this path. Okay? So these are closed paths gamma 1 up to gamma k, such that they start at x and they end at x. Okay, but this set, if I come back, if after k steps I am back at x, if I consider exactly, if I make exactly the same decision on the tree, okay, I choose, for example, here I took a step using s1, and then I took a step using s2. I do exactly the same set of decisions in the tree. Okay. When I am back here, I will be also back to the root here. So this is at least this. the same path of length k. Okay, so what I am just saying is that, as we have seen yesterday, the infinite regular tree is a cover of the graph G. Okay, so there are more walks, there are more closed walks in the graph than in the cover. Okay, so a consequence of that is that this, if you think about it, this will be larger than the largest eigenvalue. This will be larger than the largest eigenvalue of the operator A, but star when you just cut it at depth H. So you look at the operator on the tree, you cut it at depth H. Okay. And its largest, so it's a finite size graph. Its largest eigenvalue is a lower bound for the largest eigenvalue of the graph. And now that as h goes to infinity, it will converge to the norm of A star. But you can write it as plus some function which goes to zero as h goes to zero. And so you get an Allon-Boupana bound. So you see here you have used the fact that the A are positive. Because there are more terms here and all are positive. So the Allon-Boupana bound says that so Allon-Boupana, lambda 2 of A is larger than square root of the norm of A star minus some function which depends on the AIs and which goes to zero. You take H, which is the diameter of G over 2. Okay. And for example, if the AIs are equal to 1, all equal to 1, you are the usual case of for regular graphs. And you can take epsilon of H as being C over H squared. So C will depend on D, I think. I'm not sure. Okay, so in fact, the consequence of that is that not only for graphs which are locally tree-like, so the second largest eigenvalue is at least the norm of the second largest eigenvalue is at least the right edge of the operator on the infinite tree on the limit object on the tree. It's true in fact for any graph. So the tree is a graph. So the tree gives a lower bound, a universal lower bound for the second largest eigenvalue. Okay. So now, and there is an analog of the theorem by Friedman, which will say in this case that if the sigma I are uniform matching, this bound is sharp, so lambda 2 of A converge in probability of just the upper bound, the with high probability, so for any epsilon, the probability that is larger than A star plus epsilon goes to zero. Okay. So it's a slight generalization of the theorem of Friedman, but I've chosen this application because it will its proof requires ingredients which were not present in the original strategy of Friedman. And when you will see the strategy of proof of this result, you will see that there is some general picture which will emerge. Okay, so what are the hidden difficulties in this statement? Since the model is quite, the only method that people know is in order to control large eigenvalues, the only thing that comes to mind, at least at first, is to bound. You take k even, and if you find bound on the on powers of the trace, you have an. So did I say okay? The sum of ai is equal to 1, so lambda. So this is at least lambda 1 power k plus lambda 2 power k plus the other terms, but okay, it's a lower bound. This is equal to 1, okay, because I've normalized my ii's to be 1, so the constant vector is it's just a transition matrix of a Markov chain. So you would like to prove that this is of order 1, so 1 for that one, 1 plus n power this number power k. Why is there an n? Because first there is a generalization of Allon-Boppana bound due to Serre, which says that in fact there is a positive proportion of eigenvalues which are at least epsilon close to A star, to norm of A star. So it means that in any case, there are at least of order n eigenvalues which are close to that. So you have no hope to remove this n. And also you can see it on the picture here. We know that there is a without invoking the Serre results, you know that there is a positive mass here for any epsilon. So there is a positive proportion of eigenvalues. So. Okay, so you aim at that, and so you want to prove that trace of a power k minus 1 is bounded by n okay, so this bothering factor n, which is what you lost when this bound is very rough, this positive factor n, it implies that if k is much larger than log n, so you have an upper bound for lambda 2 of k, you will get that, so you write that, sorry, that lambda 2 is bounded by n power 1 over k times okay, so if k is much larger than log n, this is equal to 1 plus little of 1. Otherwise, this is at least, this is large, and you don't get the matching bound, upper bound. So you are doomed if you want to follow this strategy, which is the only one that comes to mind. You are doomed to compute, to find fine asymptotics of random walks, of countings of random walks, of a long path, which are much larger than the typical diameter of the graph. So the diameter of the graph is like log n by d minus 1, as we have seen in Eyal's lecture. But here you have to go much farther than that. Okay, so we have to prove that. So the first difficulty is that the first moment method fails. What do I mean by that? That if you have a probabilist, so when you see you want to prove that everything is positive, so you want to prove that the expectation of that. You want to prove that the expectation of that is bounded by n times if this is true for k much larger than log n, then you apply Markov inequality and you have proved your statement. Okay, but this is wrong because it's an exercise that if you look at the complete d-regular graph, it will be included in G. So that somewhere in your graph you have the complete d-regular graph. This is like n power minus c for some c like d squared. But on this event, the graph is disconnected. You have somewhere kd, and then the rest of the graph. So it implies that the graph is disconnected. So lambda 1 is equal to lambda 2 is equal to 1. It implies that the expectation of lambda 2 power k is at least the probability of this event, which is n power minus c, for any k. But this bound, but you would like to prove that but this bound, when k is larger than, when is much larger than log n, this grows, this decays faster than any polynomial. Okay, because if k is much larger than log n, a star plus epsilon power k is much less than any polynomial for any constant c. Okay? So you cannot, so the first moment method fails. The second difficulty is of combinatorial type. So there is a combinatorial problem. I mean, not problem, but is that so? If you want to compute the trace of A power K, what do I mean by that? Yes. So let's write what it is. So you will write it as a sum of all paths, which are gamma 1, gamma k, of gamma I is, so this is a vector on the vertices of the graph, which is the first n, let's say v power k. Okay. Then there is a product of the weights, which are seen along the path. Okay. And then there is the fact, there is a product of the random variables, which are the S. I didn't want it to write it like that. Gamma I is of the form. I will not use the index I. T. Where gamma T is of the form XT, YT. So I take a vertex and I choose the generator I will use. Okay? And so here you have the product of the S. You have chosen the ITs matching to go from XT to XT plus 1. Right? Okay. So I've done nothing here. I just expanded the trace. So when you have, when you do closed, so these are closed walks, so they could come back a lot to the same position, okay? But exactly as in Simonet's first lecture, these variables, they are heavy-tailed because they are equal to 0 or 1, okay, with probability 1 over n, 1 minus 1 over n, and 1 over n. So either they are completely 0 or they are very large compared to their expectation. So this sum is very sensitive. So if you spend a lot of time on an edge, it will not cost you a lot, just the probability 1 over n for the edge to be present, but it will have a huge influence on this sum. Okay, so you have to deal with when you will use probabilistic method or combinatorial method, you have to deal with kind of heavy tail variables. Okay, So you want to, you like to, and closed walks, they tend to come back a lot on edges which I've already visited. So we'll see that we'll use non-backtracking to exactly to avoid that. And the third and last difficulty, I mean, this one is a small one, is that the entries are not centered. Okay, so from a linear algebra point of view, it's just that we are interested by the trace of ak minus 1, or from a probability point of view, is that we are interested by the product of variables, but the expectation of, we have not normalized our variables, the expectation of si xy is 1 over n minus 1. So it's not 0. So we would like to, so the strategy is to solve these three problems in a very specific order. First, what did I write? Yes, I think we will see. So first, we'll solve the second problem. This will be the introduction of the non-backtracking work. Then we will deal with problem that the first moment fails. And then we will center the variables, and then we will use the method of the trace. Okay, and that's very important, the way in which you order the way you solve the three main difficulties hidden behind this problem. Okay. Okay, so the solution of the first problem, Joe Friedman found it a long time ago, and we already mentioned it a few times, is to, the second problem, so I will call you the combinatorial part, is to look at non-backtracking. So operators, maybe. So what is that? So we have already seen it a few times, so maybe I will go. So instead of defining an operator on the vertices, we define an operator on the edges, which are the vertex, and then for us, there are d outgoing edges from. So you take a vertex, and then it's xi, where. This is, you can think of that as being an half edge or directed edge. I prefer to think about it about an half edge, but it's just the way you think. Okay, so then you can define the non-backtracking operator B, which should be, was introduced by Hashimoto in various different contexts. So it's a matrix on E times E, which you can write as B in matrix form, as if E is X, I, and F is Y, J, as the indicator that, so you have X, you have Y, so you want that X is mapped to Y, so the indicator that sigma I of X is equal to Y. Okay, so this is this. And then you want that here they are mapped through the ice generator, but you want that J is different from I. So that's where the non-backtracking part is. So you follow an edge of your graph, but you don't backtrack. You can write it as B equal to, if I didn't make a mistake. Ah, and what you do with the weight, let's put the weight at the outgoing edge. So I put aj, which is the weight of f. Okay, so you could write it as a sum over all I different from j of aj si tensor product with eij Well, EIJ is the usual canonical matrix, which are equal to 1 at the entry IJ. I write that because you see that all you see from this, all the constant vector 1 is a left is an eigenvector of the all the SIs are permutation matrices. So you see that B decomposed on 1, the constant vector times C power D. There is an orthogonal decomposition of the non-backtracking operator as vectors which are constant on each vectors which take constant value for each xi, and the constant value does not depend on x. These are exactly these vectors, and the vectors which are orthogonal to that, which are vectors such as the sum of f of xi over all x is 0. Okay, so this has dimension d, and this has dimension the rest. Okay. So I will call that space H naught. And okay. So there are formulas which are probably were found in the Hashimoto, were already present in the Hashimoto paper, which are goes along the name usually of Ihara Bass formula, which is traditional for the when the AI are constant, which says the following, that the spectrum of B is equal to plus minus 1 union the set of lambda such that lambda square minus mu d plus d minus 1 is equal to 0, where mu is an eigenvalue of A. Okay, so when the AI are constant, there is a kind of dictionary which tells you if you have an eigenvalue of A, I can tell you where are the eigenvalues of B and vice versa. When the AI are not constant, there is some connections that in this example you could make explicit. But it is at the cost of not introducing the non-backtracking operator still characterizes the spectrum of A. But if you consider not only this non-backtracking operator, but a whole bunch of non-backtracking operators. And there is a beautiful formula by Nannini, Anantharaman. So let's call it Anantharaman's formula. Which is very general. So in this example, we could have done it by hand, but it's very general. So you take let mu in the spectrum of A, but which is not in the spectrum of A star. So I recall you, this is the operator on the tree. Okay, since you are not in the spectrum of the tree, you could define the resolvent like that. You can define the resolvent of the operator A at point mu. So, okay? And you consider the non-backtracking operator B mu, okay, with weights, so I will denote it by aj of mu, which are equal to you look at the inverse of the resolvent on the tree at the unit of the tree times the resolvent, the diagonal coefficient between the root between the unit of the infinite tree and the jth generator. Okay, so you take this formula, but you squeeze the weight by putting a weight, which is the ratio between, so it's constant, so this is the ratio between the resolvent at the root of the tree times the resolvent and the resolvent of between two neighboring points of the tree. Then the Anantharaman formula says the following, that one is in the spectrum of B of mu is equivalent to mu is in the spectrum of A. Okay. So I think she proved that, but because it, she didn't, it's equivalent. And the same is true on H naught. So if you restrict to, if you have an, so if the same is true of H naught and in the orthogonal of one. So if you take an eigenvector which is orthogonal to the constant vector, then there will be an eigenvector which is orthogonal, which will be in H naught of B of mu. So,
would this formula make sense? You have to assume that u belongs to the spectrum of A. Otherwise, you cannot find the result. So,
no, so it's a resolvent on R is a resolvent on the infinite tree. Okay. Okay. So then. R is well defined at mu because mu is not in the spectrum of H star. Okay, and then these weights are just good old fashioned numbers.
Yeah, but, no, but I mean, should we assume that mu belongs to the spectrum of A and minus spectrum of A star?
Ah, sorry, that's what I just but I did not wrote it the lemma the correct way. Yeah, sorry. Thanks. Okay, so in fact, it's true even if you are in the spectrum of A star, if you know that the resolvent is defined, if these numbers are well defined, but we don't need this refinement. Okay, so the proof is very easy. Once you realize that this is going to be the formula. So you can rewrite AI of mu. That will prove this implication. You write AI of mu as being, you can rewrite it as being AI times gamma I, where gamma I is the resolvent, so this is, it is the resolvent in the tree where you have removed the root and you consider it at GI, GI. Okay, so you have the root, you use, you have GI, and you remove the root and you look at what's remaining. Okay, so you can rewrite by short complements formula, or I think we already have seen this formula somewhere. Okay, and there is a recursion for this gamma I, that gamma I is equal to mu minus the sum over all j different from mu of aj gamma j minus 1. This is a short recursion, the usual short recursion on the tree. I put a minus because I've made the fancy, I've inverted the definition of the resolvent. Okay. So knowing that, that's the only ingredient that you have to know prior to the proof. You write, you take an eigenvector u. You form a vector v. So which leaves the u is in r c to the v, and v will leave in r to the e, and v of, so imagine that you have a point x, you have y, and you have, let's call y, so that will be some j, and y is equal to sigma I of x. So the, you take v of x I, which is equal to 1 over gamma I, I think, times u of, I have to check because otherwise, u of y minus ai u of x. Okay, so you make a linear combination, you have an alpha edge, and you make a linear, an oriented, you make a linear combination of the vector of the So it's a kind of derivative, where the weights are well chosen. And then you have to check that one, that B V is equal to V. Right? So it will imply that part of the. So then you just write BV of, let's take E, which is XI, which is X BV of E. It is a sum, by definition, of the J different from I of the AJ times the V YJ. Okay, so Y is a sigma I of X. So you replace the sum of j different from I of the ij. So the weight are ij gamma j now. So the first one, so it's a, maybe I write it like that, of v. So v of sigma I, it will be 1 over gamma j, v of sigma j of y minus aj of u of 1. So I just plug that definition for xi, which is equal to yj. So it simplifies it. And you sum, you find the sum over all ij v sigma j of x of y. Minus the sum over j different from I of ij squared gamma j uy.
Yes,
yes. Divided by. No, that's one. Okay. So, but now you recognize u is an eigenvalue of A. So A, if you write it at Y, this is a sum over all J. So mu UY is a sum over all J of AJ U of sigma J of Y. Okay, so here you recognize, so yeah, sorry, there is a U. Here you recognize the eigenvalue equation, but the I's term. So this is simply minus, right, AI of U of X plus mu U of Y minus sum of J different from Y of AJ squared gamma J U Y. Okay, so I've just replaced that here. And here you find the recursion, so you can factorize by U of Y. You recognize the recursion equation, and it's exactly V of. So that's very neat. So the consequence for us is, I think I've lost the top. Yeah. The consequence for us is that you can non-backtrack our first theorem, and instead of proving a statement for the matrix A, you prove a statement for the matrix B, but for all B. Okay, so I will skip some steps now that you know that there is at least in principle a way to transfer information from one world to another. And for example, you can prove that you can have a formula of A star in terms of on the tree, you can apply this formula for on the tree, and you will find that it will be the supremum of the mu, such that rho of b mu, rho of b star mu, so b star is a non-backtracking operator on the tree, is equal to 1. That will be one consequence, more or less, of this lemma. When you apply it, so here I applied for a finite size matrix, but you can there is an operator version. And you will deduce something like that. But you can characterize the operator and retrieve the Ackman-Ostrand formula if you know how to compute the spectral radius of all the non-backtracking operators. Okay, so another consequence is that if for any mu larger than what you want, rho of b mu is bounded by rho of the same thing on the tree plus some error term, then as soon as mu is larger than a star, this is strictly less than 1 by this formula. So in particular, mu cannot be eigenvalue of, so since the spectral radius is less than 1, mu cannot be eigenvalue of a. Okay, so then it implies that mu is not an eigenvalue of A. So you have to play a little bit with the epsilons. But so that's the criterion to say that if you can bound the for a family of non-backtracking operators the spectral radius, you can discard the presence of possibility of eigenvalues. So what you have to prove is that with high probability, for any mu, rho of b mu, so let's say b mu positive, whatever, is less than rho of b star. Well, the epsilon. Okay, so that's the non-backtracking reduction. So there is nothing random here. That's the non-backtracking reduction. So the non-backtracking reduction, it tells you that if you prove that, you have the first result. So that solved the second problem. That you want to count paths, but paths which do not tend to visit too many times the same vertices. The same edges, sorry. So maybe I should keep this definition for a little bit more. This we don't care anymore. Okay, so now
you only show the result for the top of the spectrum and you say that by symmetry it's the same.
No, in fact, it's just for the top two, but the AI are positive because it's just to, I made AI positive just to present the Alon-Boppana bound. But it's true, whatever the AIs are. So you can apply it to minus AI. Yeah. Okay, so to solve the first and third problem, the first one was the fact that the first moment method fails. So in fact, you have already seen most of what is going to be next, because we have already seen that in Eyal's talk that d-regular graphs or random graphs, they tend to have a few cycles, and they have no. You will not find two cycles in the same neighborhood of a graph, even if this neighborhood is quite large. Okay, so maybe I should, before doing that. So what we prove, in fact, is to the. So we from now on, I just forgot about this construction. I just take a B, which is as some weight, AI, and I forget about the mu. Now I know that if I, by some net argument, which I will not present, but I fix a given non-backtracking matrix with paths, I want to prove that rho of B is less than rho of B star. That's what I want to prove. So the bound that I have is you cannot. You look at the operator norm of L. As L goes to infinity, this converges to that. That's Gelfand formula. But it's an upper bound. So it's enough to prove that this is true for L large enough, and I forgot something important. So this is true when you take the operator restricted to H naught, because otherwise there is a trivial eigenspace. You remember, we want to speak about the second eigenvalue, not the first one, so we have to restrict ourselves to this set. So what we we have to bound the supremum of the norm of B of X of B of G over all G which are orthogonal to which are in H naught, so which are orthogonal to this vector space. That's what you want to check. So, in fact, we have understood how to, in previous papers, by notably with Laurent Massoulier and Marc Lelarge, we have proposed a method to bound that on a model which is related. And Laurent Massoulier already had a paper on a similar kind of question, so I will try to explain you this Laurent's method. So. What do? You write that exactly as we did for the adjacency matrix, which I've erased. You can expand that as a sum over gamma, which are edges of length gamma L plus 1. This one is E, this one is F. And it has to be non-backtracking, so gamma I write it as, xt jit, and it's non-backtracking, so it plus 1 is different from it, okay? You have the product of the weights that you see on this path, so they are deterministic weights, I of it for t equal to 1, so probably it's 2, it's more correct, 2 L plus 1. Times the product of xt plus 1. Okay, so I've done nothing, I've just done the same expansion that I wrote already for the adjacency matrix. So in this set there are still too many. Now we want to reduce this. So this is the deterministic set, okay? It does not depend on the randomness. The randomness is hidden here. And these are deterministic weights. So we want to reduce this cardinality, and then and that's where we will use exactly the same trick that Eyal and Alan used for to prove the cutoff on derivular graph. We use that the fact that the random graphs are tangle-free. So where maybe I will just use the notation of Eyal. Do you remember this tree axis? That the tree excess of g of x, you take a ball of radius h, the tree excess of that is less than 1 for any x with high probability if you take L which is less than 1/5, 1/4, I don't know, whatever. Okay, we saw that this morning. So it implies that b power L is equal to another operator, B parenthesis L, where I do the same thing. Maybe I will just use okay, in B parenthesis L, it's the same, but I add the fact that gamma visits at most one site. One cycle. I mean, maybe it's not clear. As at most. So gamma can be like that. This would be okay. But gamma cannot be like that or like that. Okay, whatever. So this is not possible, but this is okay. Because these two matrices would be exactly the same on this event. Because every time that you take a gamma which is not in this set, you know that this product has to be zero. Because this product is exactly checking whether or not the edge is present in the graph where you are started with. So mathematics is a lot about good definition, and this is a fantastic property of random graphs. And as you have seen, it's not difficult to check. So this simple point solves the problem one, that's the fact that the first moment fails. So this will just deal with that, and then you don't, first moment will work. But now we have a problem that we are working with a matrix, B power L, which is not anymore a power of a matrix. And we have now to recenter the entries. So what would be a recentered matrix? Okay, maybe I will use a third model. So what will be a recentered matrix is a matrix B underscore L. Well, I do the same, but I just normalize that, where S I x y is simply S I x y minus 1 over n. So I recall you, is the indicator that sigma I of x is equal to y minus 1 over n. Okay, so in this matrix, the entries are recentered. I could put n minus 1. But okay, so now I want to write to say that in the orthogonal of if G is in this, is orthogonal to this constant set space, to this vector space, these two matrices are essentially the same. This would not be quite true because we have first removed some terms in this sum. It would be true if we did not have done the first this tangle-free steps at the first. Okay, so the way you go from the matrix B power L to that one, you write that you do a telescopic decomposition. As a product of an empty product is 1. T, I want to put yt, xt minus yt, xk minus yk. Right? So I apply that to this will be xt. Okay. Yt will be that with the bar, and apply the formula, and you get that B power L of EF is B underscore L of EF plus the sum of product. Maybe I will just note that by A gamma, if you're okay with that, and this by do I want to do that? No, maybe not. Okay. No, let's forget about no extra notation. The product, so there will be A I T plus 1 S bar I T xt plus 1. The difference, which is just 1 over n, times the same thing the same thing, but with S I T X T X T plus one. Oh, maybe where I am, can I write everything? A I T plus one. Okay, so I've just done nothing. I just expanded. Now. Graphically, what's going on? I would like to. This is almost like B underscore K minus one. Okay, and this is essentially B power L minus K. So I would like to write that B power L is B underscore L. So I'm doing some kind of orthogonal projection by N. So it's times the sum of K of B underscore K minus 1. So difference will be like something like, I don't know, like kind of B tilde, where B tilde is a non-backtracking operator where I've put just on the complete graph. So what was EIJ? Times B power L minus K. K, and there is a 1 over N. Yeah. OK, this is not, so if you look at this sum, it will count paths which are non-backtracking during K minus 1 steps. Then you do one step, one non-backtracking step. And then you continue and you do L minus K extra steps, which are non-backtracking. But you see that here, this path, the total path is has two cycles, even if each of the chunks has just one cycle. So this sum is larger than that sum. So I have to remove some stuff which count exactly a configuration like that. And okay, so R of the L is exactly it counting configuration like that, and or configuration like I don't know, like that, or etc. And so on. So now, if G, if your graph is if this property on this event, you can remove the you find that B power L. This event that there is no graph with a large tree excess, no subgraph with a large tree excess. But then I want to test that for a vector which is orthogonal to C power D. So G, a vector which was in H naught. Okay, but it's easy to see that the kernel of B tilde, it contains H naught. Okay, because in B tilde, you just sum over all vertices. So if the sum over all edge which have the same I of the sum over all vertices, it will be zero. So the kernel of B naught includes to zero. So, and also that B is, as we have seen, there is an orthogonal decomposition, and B of H naught is included in H naught. So in particular, if G is in H naught, BL of G is BL of G plus this will be an element of H naught because G is in H naught. This is in the kernel, so everything is zero. So what we have done, this painful computation, is just that we have done the orthogonal projection, but once we have removed some paths. So it has just created some error terms, which fortunately are not too bad. So you deduce that if, let's call this EL, this event, if EL holds, the norm of BL G on H restricted to H naught is bounded by the operator norm of B power L plus the norm of R L. So these are operator norms divided by N. And now the proof continues, but we stop. Now you can apply the trace method. That's where. Yes, I will not have enough time, so maybe I will start the first line. So by using the trace method, you can prove two statements that if you take a row which is larger than rho of B star plus epsilon, we prove that the operator norm of that is bounded. So for example, its expectation. That we have high probability, so with probability tending to 1. This is bounded by some log n power, 50 times rho. And the norm of R is also bounded by C power, I also some rho power L, is bounded by some log n factor times some constant C power L. So you prove that, and it allows you to conclude because you take an L which is, for example, much little low of log n, but which is much larger than log n, and you will deduce that on this event. On the union, on the intersection of those three events, the norm of the spectral radius will be bounded by rho power L plus some rho plus some minor corrections. And maybe. So and in the trace method, you take I power of this matrix B power L, you expand into paths, and there are a combinatorial paths part, which is counting paths, counting the number of paths which arise. But since there are each bit of length L is tangle free, the paths, they cannot visit many times a single vertex easily. And then there is a probabilistic part, which is to estimate the product of this. There is a probabilistic part, which is to have a fine estimate of expression like that in expectation. Okay, and what will happen is that if that's where the fact that the entries are centered plays a role. That you will bounded that by some constant times n power minus the number of visited edges. So you have a path. So you have xt plus 1, which are met an edge with it. So this defines a graph, right? Which has a certain number of distinct vertices, it's a. And you have a discount factor, which is also like k. Maybe 4 divided by n power minus the number of edges which are visited once. So when you visit only once a vertex, you feel the fact that the expectation is close to zero because this is small. This is in the regime where k is much less than square root n. This will be a term which goes to zero. So this is only a probabilistic part of the proof. It is to prove this lemma. And you have to prove it for k, which is much larger than log n, which is not completely trivial. But I have no time to explain you in detail this proof. So to conclude, so in fact, with Benoît Collins, so we when I came with this argument, we tried to generalize it to other models. And so you see there is a general picture which emerged, which is any Hermitian matrix defined locally on your graph. You can non-backtrack this problem and hope for the best in following this path. Okay. And okay. So what I've talked so far is just works which have been more or less connected with. So but there have been a lot of recent works on sparse graphs, just within the last few years, just on the spectrum of sparse graphs. So I just wanted to cite some very nice works in the minutes I have, just sort of to give you some advice of lecture during the summer holidays. So yeah, so I wanted to mention. So this was more or less with Benoit Collins, an extension of that. So in the last few years, so on sparse on the spectrum of sparse graphs. There are much more than what I presented, of course. So, for example, there have been, for example, the existence of infinite sequence of bipartite graphs, of bipartite Ramanujan graphs. By Marcus Spielmann and Srivastava. I think this is the most relies on probabilistic construction related to a model of random graphs, which are closely related to the one I've presented. There are the very nice work of Nalini and Antaraman. PhD students on the quantum ergodic theorems, quantum ergodicity for finite graphs. So, which are related to delocalization properties, which implies some delocalization properties of eigenvectors of graphs. There are also very nice work of Agnès Backhaus and Balazs Zsigédy on typical eigenvectors in regular graphs. Okay, so all these papers, they just came within 3 or 4 years ago. And they will use methods which are completely they have almost an empty intersection with everything I've told so far. So I think it's quite amazing for a field. There is also, I wanted to cite 2 more works. We have seen some result on, for the weak topology, the spectral measure is continuous, but you can say much more and try to derive very sharp rates of convergence of, for example, the Kesten-McKay measure. So there are local laws by Bauer-Schmidt, Wong and Yao on regular graphs, which are, I think it's a very impressive paper. And finally, there are nice works on the invertibility of, which I've never talked about, and of adjacency matrices. And the related copic of directed graphs, directed random graphs, where the question is to, for the invertibility of adjacency matrices, is to know whether or not, for example, if you take a dirregular graph, whether or not zero is in the spectrum. So there are works by Nicolas Cook and Pierre Youssef and I don't know if you hear, and co-authors. He has many co-authors. So. Okay, so I think there are very nice papers within the last few years, and it shows that there are many things to do in this field. So, thanks.